So, you probably already know this, but I didn't. I used to think that healing and the church's job, you know, when we work with children and when we work with healing, was to go from I'm okay, and then something would hurt somebody, little squinchy face, and then God, the church, you know, healing, whatever would happen, and they would return to okay. So I thought, you know, you'll be happy again. You know, it happens. And then, and I've never really thought a lot about that. I just sort of had that assumption, you know. I just thought, oh, of course that's how it works. You know, you're happy, something bad happens, you return to happy. And then my own life happened, and I had, you know, same old stuff everybody's got. And then my mom died of Lou Gehrig's disease. And then my dad had a massive heart attack at a wedding rehearsal 12 days later. And died. And then my husband had left me. And then my niece came to live with me. She was 16. Great time to take in a niece who used to be the cool aunt. Like, we'd crawl in windows to meet Marky Mark and the Funky Bunch. And then, you know, finally I was saying, you know, oh, what time will you be home? That was a great transition. You can only imagine. I went from cool aunt to mommy in 12 days. So anyway, I learned that I'm happy again. And I have a friend named Brenda. And for the year after my parents died and stuff, I would go to Brenda's house and sit in her chair. And I would say to her, you know, gosh, you know, I'll never be happy again. It's over. And she would just say, okay. Okay. And I was convinced I would never be happy again. And I loved God. And God was with me. But God wasn't taking me back to the old person that I was. And so I found this out in my own life, and then I found this as I journeyed with children, that you will be happy again. God did not create us to never be happy again. It's just not how God made anything. And everything rebirths, right? I went to Israel, and I went to the Golan Heights where the bombs had hit. I've never been in an area where a bomb went off. So we went to the Golan Heights and we saw where all these bombs had dropped, and there were these huge craters and we could go down in them and look. And I was amazed. There were these little white flowers growing in all of that ash and all of that blackness. And I thought, wow, God really does make things to rejuvenate. You know, there's just never an end. Even a bomb that violent, it still rejuvenates. So when I worked with the children, what I discovered was that you're happy. Something happens to you. Now, some people never leave this. They're forever unhappy. But for the people that are able to work through their pain and really do some work around that pain, so what happens to a lot of people is they're unhappy, but then they go back and they pretend like they're happy. Now, these are the people that chew you up over nothing. They're mad at you over the darndest thing, and it has nothing to do with it, because really they're living down here and they're trying to act like they're happy. So this is the person who loses their cookies because you forgot to, you know, have the googly eyes there on a Sunday, and they're just, you know, screaming. I guarantee it's something about this. It's not really that much about the googly eyes. So you go down there. But people who are able to work through their pain, and that's what we're going to do with children, is help them work through their pain. And you can see how all this applies to adults, right? I call it the trickle-up thing. You do it with children, it'll trickle up. I don't know about trickle-down economics, but I do know about trickle-up children stuff. It moves up. So if they work through their pain, they end up happy again, but they're not this. So if your mom or dad dies, you will never be this again. If your brother kills himself, you will never be that. You'll never be that naive again. And life is a series of these hurts. So really, in our life, you know, it looks like we have some little hurts, and then we have a big hurt, and then we have a little hurt, and then we have a big hurt. And this is what life looks like. And the goal is to keep moving through life and not get stuck at any of these points, because that's death. That's spiritual death. And we don't believe in death because we have a Savior who rose. So we know that the real truth is life, death, resurrection. Life, death, resurrection. I have a friend who's a psychiatrist, and he says to me, he loves my work. We travel around a lot. And he says, is there anything as a broken soul? Like, is there a point where you just give up on a kid? And I said to him, and he says, because scientifically, like, I think there are kids that are just so wounded that we kind of give up on them. And I said, I can't give up on them because that's not my story. My story is life, death, resurrection. So I don't care how wounded a child is, I'm waiting for resurrection every time I meet with them. I don't care how wounded an adult is, I'm waiting for resurrection because that's our story, resurrection. Now, suicide breaks my heart because suicide goes beneath this and they forgot about resurrection. That's when people suicide, is when they can no longer see this half of their life. So I have to help people move through this so that they know that there's always something that comes after their pain. So that's that. All right. Then I want to talk about this little thing, the happiness part again. And then we'll get into the nuts and bolts of all this. All right. So this, while I draw a happy face, is not always happy for people. What healing looks like, what the children showed me that healing looks like, it's when you're okay. You know that God is there. But life isn't happy or sad. That's black and white thinking. It's naive thinking. And for most of us, if we really got deep with one another right now, we probably have this mix of happy and sad going on. We're still affected by things that are happening. Some of us are fighting with our spouses. Some of us are worried about our children. Like, nobody is happy. Happy. We've all got something. And if you look at your life collectively, you've had some stuff. So what we tend to do as a society is say, well, you're happy or you're sad. Which are you? Choose one. Well, it's ridiculous. And by the way, you know what? TV commercials, which we didn't even talk about the effect of children. I think is it $1.5 billion is spent on advertising to children currently. Have you watched the Nickelodeon channel lately? Every time I watch it with my grandchildren, they go, oh, I want a sham wow. I want a shower wow. Everything's called wow. I want balloon wow. I want, you know, they just want. That's all that advertising to children. So the advertising tells us this, right? Our teeth have to be white. Oh, we have to look perfect, blah, blah, blah. I just heard a very disturbing thing on, I don't have a TV, but I do watch the Today Show sometimes and at my grandchildren's house. And I heard that now if you don't get plastic surgery, you're going to start standing out. So let me just tell you, I'm going down with the ship, so I'll be the 900 old looking woman at, you know, 55 when everybody else looks 20 because they've all had plastic surgery. Oh boy, aren't we buying into this? Suddenly, you know, shooting poison in our faces is a good idea. I'm sorry if I offended anyone who's had a lot of Botox. Anyway. So this is ridiculous. And this is what our society wants us to believe. We are happy. We are happy. Happy, 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 happy. No, this is what we need to create, are people that are real, authentic. So what we want is authenticity. And what going through this you does is it makes you very real, very real. You know, the children, I'll get to this, but the children that I dealt with, almost every one of them turn into a healer at some point if they've really worked through their stuff. And they just have this, and people say, isn't it awful that a child has a death of a parent or whatever? It's sad. But I'll tell you, some of the most amazing adults that I know are people that faced real difficulty as children because they had to face their authentic self. They weren't insulated in this happy box. And so for lots of people, these are the people that become the healers and the leaders and the people. They just have an empathy that you can't get any other way than going through this. So what I look for, what my definition of healing is that you are happy. You know, of course you are. We're all happy at some point or another. But you're also aware that life is not perfect. You have your sorrows, you have your sadness, you have your grief. If you're 7 and mommy died and now you're 21, you still miss your mommy every time. You know, my parents have been dead now for, I think, 30 years, and on their birthdays, I always have to figure out how old they are, and I have a little thing for them, and I miss them. And the other day, I got my feelings hurt, and I wanted to call my mom so much, and I tried talking to her in heaven, but it's not the same as hearing her voice on the phone. And you know, like, it's forever, okay, but you know what, there's God, there's hope, there's love, and this is what makes you okay. You know, an integrated person is what we're looking for. Someone that understands that, you know, I've been through this pain, but I'm okay. So I call this point spiritual integration just because I had to do it from a doctorate. But this is really what we're looking for. It's where we're authentic. We're happy. We're sad. God's in the midst of it. There's hope. There's tomorrow is coming. That's really where you want people to get. I had a guy in my church whose child had been murdered. And I gave this little talk about children. He came up bawling. And I said to him, I'm sorry, upset you, you know, what can do? And he said, no. He said, for the last 30 years, I've thought I wasn't healed. Nobody told me that I'm allowed to be this. I was waiting to be all happy again. Thank you for giving me the freedom. And the same with children. Our goal is not to bring them back to happy. It's not going to happen. Our goal is to let them be authentic with us. And the other reason this works is that it's, again, the Trinity, where this work that we do is not us. We are not the ones that heal children. We're not the ones that bring wholeness to children. God is. So what we do is hold the space with a child. We let them be that authentic self, which means lots of times it's going to look like this. We don't want that in children. We don't want children to cry. I had a kid that came to my center. His dad died. He was so upset that when he would try to talk, his little tongue would choke himself. And he would have to stick his two fingers. He thought he was going to die. He thought he couldn't breathe. Now, he would have breathed, right? So this just became kind of a weird habit that he had. But he would stick his fingers down there and be like, before I can tell you anything else, I can't breathe. And that's painful to watch. But that's authentic. So we have to be willing to go into this. And see, this is again why this is the church's work. Because we know that there is no darkness that shatters us. The light comes. Resurrection follows. If we are not ready to go down into these sacred spaces and these dark places with children, I don't believe that the secular world can do it. I could be wrong. I can't do it. We go down here because we know that the light comes. We believe in the resurrection. So this is so authenticity is what we're looking for in children, and authentic is what we need to be with children. So as you do this work, you can't be I hear a lot about emotional detachment. Now, granted, you can't take home every hurting child that comes into your life, and you can't go home and bawl every night, but maybe you can. I don't know. The thing is, you're going to be authentic. The child's going to be authentic. If you love that child and you're ready to hear everything and you suspend judgment, that child's going to tell you a lot of stuff. If you judge that child, they are going to know it, and they are going to shut down. So if you can't handle a tattoo, you're probably not going to be able to do this work very effectively. Because teenagers now tattoo their feelings right on their bodies. If you don't like a tattoo, you're missing a big part of their message. I remember I opened my door once, and there was this kid standing there, and he had that hair that looks like a dinosaur, like sticking up like that, you know? And I thought, oh, heavens. And I said to him, hi, are you my 4 o'clock? Yes, I am. Would you like a cookie? And he just laughed. You know, I said, I'm sorry, my room looks a little babyish for you or whatever. I named it, and we ended up seeing each other for forever. You know, he just healed. And, you know, so it's just being present with them and not judging them. And you can't judge their parents either. Their parents are trying. It's hard. You just don't be judgmental. Just be present. Just be an authentic presence with the child. Because Jesus said, where two are gathered, there I am in the midst of them. And all of this that I'm going to talk to you about goes around this scripture, where two are gathered, there I will be in the midst. So what we're doing is we are creating holy space with a child, and they will be able to go into the heart of God and find healing. It is not you that will heal them. Everybody used to say to me when I started First Steps, well, oh my gosh, of course kids are going to talk to you like you're a kid magnet. And I really am. Like, I'll be at a restaurant and I'll just be eating my dinner or whatever, and I look over, and this probably happens to some of you children's people too, and there'll be a kid standing there, like 4-year-old, and his parents don't realize he's escaped from their table. And I look over and I say, well, hi. And then he says, hi, I have light up tennis shoes. And I go, well, you sure do. And then their mother looks over and says, oh, is he bothering you? I said, no, he just wanted to show me his tennis shoes. My own children go like, that's freaky. That just weird kids come up to you. That's really freaky, mom. But it just is what it is, right? You know, lost children find me at the amusement park. They just think I look good, whatever. Sherry says, hey, listen, you know, of course kids are going to heal with you. You're a healer. No. Kids will heal with anybody who creates sacred space because God is the healer. Has nothing to do with my personality. Has anything. So people say, well, you know, you're an extrovert. This morning I said to Jamie, you know, I'm a total extrovert. And she says, oh, no, I never noticed. But so my introverted people go like, well, I'm an introvert. I don't know if I can do this work. Are you kidding? It's even better because you can keep your mouth shut for 2 seconds. You know how hard it is for me to do holy listening? It doesn't come natural. So it's not personality driven. You are holding a space. What this is faith-based, because you either believe that God will heal a child or you don't. And if you don't believe it, then okay. But if you can even hold the space and you don't believe it, I guarantee you'll be a believer by the time you meet with a few kids. Because God will show you how powerful God is if you hold the space. So all this is designed for you to hold a space. Now, ta-da! 2.5 years of my life. 2.5 years. Everybody be duly impressed. All right. This is what we're going to do. We're going to just go through this and we're going to learn how to do it. All right. So the first thing that happens when you meet with children is the arrival and initial conversation. Now, this is for a kid that you've never met before, right? But in the church, you're doing this part every single Sunday. Every single Sunday. When you say to that kid, oh, I noticed that you lost a tooth. You know how excited they are about losing their teeth? Oh, I'll tell you one thing. This is off topic. My granddaughter is 6. Yeah, I've never heard of a kid doing this. She saves her teeth, like in a bank thing. And when she needs money, she puts a tooth under her pillow. Have you ever heard of a kid do that? I have never. In all the thousands of children, she saves her teeth. It's like a little banking system she's got. She's like, oh, I want a toy. I think I'll put a tooth under my pillow tonight. She's got like 5 of them saved up. It's crazy. Okay, anyway, you're doing this every week. When you say to a kid, oh, you lost a tooth. Oh, did you get a haircut? How was school? Like those Broncos? Da-da-da. You're just, you know, good morning. I'm glad you're here. You are building rapport. Again, this is that relational piece. If you can't build a relationship, you know, you can't have it. So when a kid comes to you that you've never seen before, you know, this kid's tougher, which is why I had Jenny baking cookies, because they came in and they ate some cookies, and, you know, cookies are naughty. And I lived in Colorado. Everybody wants you to do carrot sticks and stuff. And I said to them, you know what? A carrot stick does not say, I'm one of you. A carrot stick says, I'm an adult and I want you to be healthy. A cookie says, let's eat. Right? So we had cookies and I had some granola bars for, you know, the hardcore parents, whatever. All right, so arrival initial conversation. This is just getting to know a kid. And it's also understanding that you have a mission to do. And your mission is to help this hurting child go through a little you. And when they do it, it will feel better. So on this thing, as you see, there's the arrival initial conversation. Then the goal of it is to have the child name a core statement. This is authenticity. So core statement / authenticity. You want the child to tell you something that they really believe, not the right answer. All of us know what the right answer is. Your mother has died. How do you feel? Fine. Right answer. Do you feel like enough people are listening to you? Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm great. I'm great. What do you do with your grief? I play video games. I feel a lot better when I play video games. I'm fine. Yeah, yeah. Or if they're past fourth grade, they just put their head, their little hat over their face, right? And they refuse to look at you. Real hard to bond when they've got that hat down there. You do it anyway. Your goal is to push beyond light and move down here. Now, imagine the difficulty in this, because we live in a society that wants to keep us in that upper third. We're going to look great. We're not going to age. We're not going to ever have a bad feeling. If we get depressed, we're going to take some medicine immediately. We're going to just, stay up there. Stay up there. Happy, happy, happy. So it's real hard to get past that, except you're going to know when you use symbolic language tools how easy it is. So, and children are the path of least resistance. They're like so darn easy. If I had to do a grief group with adults, oh, I do them, but I just beat my head on the wall. It's so darn hard to get adults to do this model. But children, snap. So you want them to be authentic. All right, so let's talk about how you get a child to be authentic. Basically, what you do is you understand the language of children. I keep pointing the thing the wrong way. And children do not speak with words. They speak through symbols. We all do, really. It's why the early churches, you know, you ever go to Italy and you walk in that church and you're just overcome with the beauty of it. and you feel God's presence. I've had friends that are atheists who say, I just had a friend get home, he and his, well, they're gay. He and his partner got home and he said, you know, I haven't been to the church in like a million years, and I walked in the cathedrals and I was just bawling because I could feel the presence of God in there. I mean, it's just so beautiful, the decorations and stuff. Symbols are really, and Jesus understood the power of symbols, right? What is the kingdom of God like? It's like a mustard seed. It's like a pearl. It's like. Jesus understood the power of symbols and metaphor. And it's the same with children. So imagine if you're a child and you're 7 and your mother is an alcoholic. You don't know what alcoholism is. You don't know that your mother is different than any other mother of anybody in the world. And it feels really crummy. But how do you even start to tell somebody what that feeling is? You don't have the words. So you use words like, it makes me feel bad, it makes me feel sad. That isn't a lot of information. That doesn't really help them go, you don't have anything to ask them about that, right? So what we do, and what I do, is just give them their tools, which is like childlike stuff. So these are feeling masks. And we did these at a grief camp that we did. And I just wanted to show you like how I love this one particularly. This kid, his mother had cancer and died. He's a teenager, or preteen. He was like 10 years old. His mother died, and they were going to turn off the machine, and he wanted to be there, but he didn't tell anybody, and he went to lunch, and when he came back, they had already disconnected her machine, and he went crazy. He got in a wheelchair. I chased that kid all over a hospital, I'm telling you. They called me, and they were like, he's freaked out. He won't get out of the wheelchair. I mean, he was like terrorizing the hospital. Anyway, and so he says, well, here's how I am. That's what my friend sees, a soldier. It's tough. And then there he is on the inside just crying. This is a little girl whose mother died when she was 2. And, you know, it's funny. I went to her church when she was 2. I held her on my lap. And we did a flower ceremony. All the children in the church brought her a flower and put her in a vase. 14 years later, I end up at First United Methodist Church again. And that was at St. Paul United Methodist Church. She'd come over and she recognized me. I know. And that was my little 2-year-old that I had sat with when her mother died. Anyway, this is her outside of her mask, and there's her inside. She's found her light. She's hopeful. You know, there's a light in the darkness. So the first thing is drawings, right? You give them a crayon. So all you need is a basket. You're going to put some crayons in it. You're going to put some rocks in it, and that's all you're going to need. Okay, so that's your kit that you're going to take and have available for hurting kids. So when a kid walks in off the street, you grab your basket. You've already got it ready. It's got some crayons, some paper, some rocks. That's what you're going to have. Some clay if you want, a little sandbox if you want, whatever. Okay, so this is a kid who says, I said, you know, draw me a picture of how you're feeling. And I saw this. I thought, oh my gosh, her parents were getting divorced. And I thought, oh my gosh, look at that little thing down there alone, you know. And she said, oh, that's not me, that's Jesus. That's Jesus in his little overalls. I love him so much. And she said, my family's that tree. We've fallen apart. We have fallen apart. It used to be green and healthy, and now we're just scattered everywhere, and I'm just hoping that Jesus puts those leaves back on that tree. Now, that's a core statement. See where you're going? That's authentic. This is a little girl who, most of my kids are extreme because, you know, I had a spirituality center and I picked my most dramatic pictures, but this little girl, her dad was mountain climbing in Colorado, and he fell, and he died. And his friend stayed with him till he died. You talk about a messed up friend. But anyway, this little girl the police came to the door to tell her mom that the dad had died on the mountain. And her mother did a thing that we probably maybe always done. And she said to her, you know, if you're not good, I'm going to call the police. Probably not like the best thing to ever do. And she rues the day she ever did it. But anyway, the little girl saw the police come and thought they were coming to get her because she'd been fighting with her brother. So she hid under a table. And she's teeny, like this big. And so the police told her mother, and she heard it. She heard her mother scream. Like nobody told her gently that her dad died. And she started drawing pictures, and she drew berries. These are her berries. And eventually, I kept saying to her, what are the berries? I don't know. Well, do the berries mean anything? I don't know, but I knew they were important because they were in every picture. The bulletin at her dad's service was her and her dad and her brother and her mom and 2 berries. There were always these berries. And then eventually, one of the berries grew into a flower. And then eventually all the berries started growing into flowers. That was like her little self cut off in her dad. And then she said, oh yeah, that was daddy's favorite color. And I would say to her, so the berries were your grief? And she was like, well, I don't know. She's four. How would she know? She didn't know. So that's her core statement. This is a child who told me she was fine. Her dad had been deployed now for about the hundredth zillionth time. This is her self-portrait. She's fine. Now, this is why the drawings are so important. How on earth would that little girl ever, ever tell me how that feels? But she could show me. So the thing isn't tell me how you feel, it's show me. Show me how you feel. And the other beauty of this is that when you meet with a child, a hurting child, it's all of us, right? Your defenses go up. My parents died, and you know, I was a minister of a church, and so it was very public, and people were very worried about me. And, you know, they should have been. But they would say to me, you know, how do you feel? And I would say, fine, because I just didn't want to go into it. Or, you know, it'd be like you just have that thing. And then if I ever did break down, you know, and I'd cry, and then they'd go and look at their watch, and I'd think, oh, I took too long to tell them that I was, you know. Ugh. And so, and children are the worst at this, right? When you ask them something, they push back. They just do this. You know, it's the same, like you see it. You know, time for bed. I'm not going to bed. Oh, no, you can't have an M&M. Yes, I am. You know how they go back and forth, back and forth. So a lot of this process, children are just like adults. They don't want to go below that upper third. That's safe. That feels really good to stay in the upper third of your life. Just pretend like everything's okay. When you invite them to go beneath that, then it gets really vulnerable. Nobody wants to be vulnerable. So they'll push back and say, I'm, you know, they won't tell you. They'll shut down. They'll put their hat over their face, whatever. But if you say, show me, it breaks that tension. So we're going back and forth with tension. You tell me, no, no, no. And then instead I go, show me. And we're both looking at some rocks. It becomes safe. We're both looking at a picture. It becomes safe. So it breaks that tension between you. So those are the drawings of children. And then you can also use, some of my favorite. This is a little girl who thought she was ugly. She had a cleft palate, and her mother was a single mom, and couldn't get it fixed right away. And sometimes, depending on the severity of a cleft palate, you can get it fixed easier than others. But her mom didn't have insurance and did the best that she could. But she really needed plastic surgery, and they just didn't have it in the budget or whatever. And so she would go to school, and her little cleft palate sometimes would bleed. And then the kids would, like, make fun of her and call her, like, bleedy mouth and everything. And so she came to me. She was, like, about 11, beautiful, red hair, looked like Ariel the princess or something, but she definitely had a cleft palate. Interesting, her mother never took her to church, and she always referred to God as she. And I thought that was so interesting. She was like, well, yeah, when I talked to her, and I'm like, who are you talking to? She's like, God. God, just totally female. I thought it was interesting. Anyway, this is her picture, and she says, that used to be my life, that big volcano, before she came to the center. It just was like, I didn't want to go to school. It was awful. And I just felt so ugly. And then there's a little dot. See, in the middle of that river, there's a little river that runs through it. There's a little dot right there. She says, I'm right there. But I'd like to get to where I look in a mirror and see my real reflection and love myself. That's where I'm heading. So she isn't there yet, but she's not where she was. And she explains that to me. So again, it's the power of symbols. These are my holy listening stones, and they're just a group of rocks that have symbols on them. They don't mean anything. They're just symbols. I mean, obviously the broken heart means broken heart, but I mean, there isn't like a Jesus one, there's not an angel one, there's not a Star of David one, because what will happen if you put a cross there is all the children will say, Jesus, right answer, stay in that upper third. Are you happy with me? Can I get out of here now? I said, Jesus, I'm done. So these rocks have been, if I never invent another thing, I'm very happy with my rocks. So this shows you some of the ways that they use them. This is in the sandbox. But anyway, on that side are all the sad rocks. So this kid said, you know, their parents are divorcing. I'm really, really sad about the divorce. I've been really sad. It's been going on for like a year now. I'm really, really sad. And then they put the happy rocks over here. And the one in the middle is a little foot, and it's pointing this direction. And they said, I'm not healed yet. I'm not totally happy yet. But I don't want to go back. This is how I did feel. So you see, they can tell, they see how the symbols work. They just start telling you about yourself. And while they're doing this, you're not going into Oprah Winfrey analytical mode or Dr. Phil or whatever. You're just sitting there, Dr. Phil. You're not going into that. You're just listening. So what is your job? to hold the sacred space. Because the child thinks they're talking to you, and they are, but God is there. So really, they're sharing their authentic self with God. And you're just listening. You're just holding a space. Now, if a child says to you, I'm not happy yet, and you say, I think you are. I saw you playing. You looked really happy. You shut them down. You see? So we don't do anything. This is like the easiest job in the world. Everybody thinks this is super hard. It's super easy. The hard part is keeping your mouth shut. The hard part is not judging. The hard part is not rolling your eyes, right? And so you just got to sit there. Now people say, well, do you sit there detached? Are you like a you know, no. No, you're yourself. You come to the space authentic because you want the child to be authentic. You can't fake this stuff. So you're authentic, they'll be authentic. You're fake, they'll be fake. You judge, they'll shut down. I'm just telling you, you got to be totally open. And sometimes we have to set our theology aside. So, for example, we'll use divorce. There's a lot of people that believe that divorce is really, really bad, and it was not what God intended. And guess what? I'm divorced twice. I am not proud of that. And I understand the pain of that like nobody's business. But my theology is still that God created us to be married for our whole lives to one person. Now, if I'm a person that believes that divorce is the worst thing that ever happened, and then a child says, you know, my parents are divorced, and immediately you're judging that child, which, by the way, they didn't get divorced. So you can judge their parents if you want, but heaven's sakes, don't judge the child who's, you know, just the product of they can't get along. But if you're judgmental about that, or if it's Sunday school every week, you talk about how horrible divorce is, that child will never tell you that their parents are getting divorced. So it's not that we don't teach theology, it's that we're sensitive to that. So for example, on a Sunday morning, well, we'll get to that, but you might want to include in your illustration sometimes a single mom or a single dad or a stepmom or a stepdad. And I guarantee it doesn't make children turn into people that want to get divorced. I've never met a child who says, you know, my mom's an alcoholic, I hope to grow up and be one. It's okay. It's magical thinking to think if we ever mention something, it'll start happening. So again, it's just being where they're at. So if you're going to judge them, don't do the work. There's the rocks, and that's what they look like. So for example, see the rock that's the swirly, like next to the arrow that goes that way, the swirly one? Kids will see that rock, and they'll say, that's how I feel. It's swirly. I just feel like I'm being flushed down a toilet. It's swirly. See, it gives them language for what they otherwise couldn't do. So I want to take just a few minutes here, and I want you to just practice a little bit with symbolic language. We're going to use these stones. It's better if we had stones on the table, but I didn't plan ahead like that. So what I want you to do is get into pairs or groups of three, whatever you'd like. But if you get in a group of three, you know, you're going to talk extra long. We're not going to give you that much time. So I'd suggest pairs because we're girls. So what I want you to do is I want you to sit here. We're going to enter a time of silence for about, you know, a minute. And I want you to look at those rocks, and I want you to just say, where are you at in your life currently? Now, obviously, you don't know each other, so you don't have to dump out all your stuff. We're not going to go to the bottom of your you, but if you want to, feel free. We're all trustworthy. And you're going to share with somebody, where are you at? Where are you at currently in your life? And you don't have to be sad today. You can be happy. It's all right. Pick three stones, and then I'd like you just to get in pairs and just share with one another the stone. If you're the person sharing, you share. If you're the person listening, then what you're going to say is, okay? You're not going to be like, oh, me too, I can beat that. You're just going to be like, Or you might ask a clarifying question, how come? Well, and you know the best word you can use with a hurting child? Thank you for being honest. Wow. I've said thank you more since I started working with hurting kids than I ever did growing up in Kentucky, where you had to say thank you, ma'am, thank you, sir, every time you did anything. Thank you for being honest. So you can say thank you if you want. You can say nothing, but you can't trump them. So if they're feeling bad because they blah, blah, you can't trump it. You just listen. We're going to practice listening and talking, okay? So let's enter a time of silence. Everybody look up there and see which rocks you like. All right, when you get your three stones, you might want to draw them on a little piece of paper or something. And then let's just take a few minutes and share with one another. And, you know, 5 minutes, something like that. So just share with each other kind of your how you're feeling today. Okay, good. There. Thank you for doing that. You know, it reminded me, you all saying, wait, we're in the middle of something important. I did a thing for hurting kids, and we had Santa Claus come. It was at a cancer thing. And the kids lined up, and Santa, like, it was really Santa, like the real one, I think, because the guy loved kids like nobody's business. And the line got really long for the kids to go see Santa Claus. And I was like losing it, you know, like, we're not going to have time for the gingerbread, blah, whatever, you know, we had all this stuff to do, and Santa was taking so long with those kids. And so I said to my volunteers, go in and tell Santa to hurry. So they went in and they said, Santa said he won't hurry. And I was like, I will go tell Santa. I've got an agenda. Woo. So I go in there and I'm stopped in my track, and there's these little bald-headed kids. And like the one that was on Santa's lap currently had his little beard and was just talking and talking, and Santa was crying. And I said, oh, okay, never mind. Took the agenda, put it aside, let Santa do his work. You know, isn't that why we remember our visits to Santa? Because we were the most important thing in the world to him. What do you want for Christmas? Tell me about you. Have you been a good girl? Have you been a good boy? Santa loves you. Now that just shows me how little this happens in our lives. And our busy parents, I'm not talking smack about them. I'm telling you, they don't have time. We have to remember that this process takes time. And that's why I loved when you said, we're not done. You know, I saw these hurting kids, and I had to start scheduling like 20 minutes in between because I didn't know what time it would end, because it just takes the amount of time it takes. And at church, if we're so busy on Sunday mornings doing our, you know, who's in this classroom, who's in that, whatever, I really encourage churches to have holy listeners available every single Sunday, a holy listener. We'll get to that in a minute. But somebody who is there just to listen to children. Because you don't have time as the Christian educator or the teacher in the class or the whatever. You've got your agenda, and you can't stop the whole class because there's one kid that's upset. But there will be upset children. You need to prepare for that. And we'll get to that later. But just remember that this is a rare gift. And that's why children take to it so easily. They don't get this. Nobody says, how are you? So if you go to a child authentically, you think this is hard. I'm telling you, it is melting butter. I would compare it to melting butter. That's how much they open up. And it's almost pitiful what they will tell you. In, you know, these complete stranger children would come to me, and within 5 minutes and a cookie, I could establish complete rapport with them. And I don't want to go back to our dark statistics, but you know who understands this? Pedophiles. They understand how easy it is for a child to trust you. That's why this has to happen in churches, where there are background checks, where there are two adults, where we already have those safety measures in place. Because you really don't want this happening with your neighbor that you've never met. And certainly not the guy or the woman on the internet. Right? This is why the church can do this work, because we have it in place. We're the perfect space for this to happen. You know, I love the this new emerging church thing. You know, my cousin has a church, and it's in a laundromat. And they have jazz music, and they go into the laundromat twice a Sunday, and they do church. And it's cool. And, like, all these people now come and blah, blah, blah. And I said to him, what do you do with the kids? And he says, well, I got another friend. They're doing a thing in the park. And I go, what do you do with the kids? And they say, the churches have classrooms and spaces and crayons and paper. We can't, you know, we got to say, look, we got to have the church, the building. Everyone's like, oh, we're not the building, we're the people. But we also need buildings, because children need to be dropped off. They need to be safe. They need to, you know. So, I say, people, well, you know, the church can go under. Can I have the buildings? Because I'd like to do something in those buildings still. Yeah, my bishop loves that. Okay. So you get this. I'm not going to go through all these pictures with you, but you can see that, like, sandboxes, rocks, and everyone says, well, now why do you use stuff? Like, why don't you just, you know, paper is great. It's the easiest. But these things, like a rock, a sandbox where they can do their feelings. These are all very exciting things. Well, I'll tell you about this one just quickly. This is a kid who was abused by his mother. And he said to me, you know, if I told you everything my mother did to me, your head would explode. I believe him. You believe him, don't you? And he said, my life is swirly. See how he did all those pipe cleaners, and then there's swirly marbles. And he put a little swing in the middle, and he lit two candles, and he said, I just want to not feel swirly. And, you know, if I wanted to be all Freudian or psychological, I'd say he once rocked, right, by a mother that never nurtured him. So the reason I use sandboxes and rocks and stuff like that is because it's what children love. And there's something about those things. Watch a child, go to a park. If you want to see what to use, go to a park and watch a three-year-old. And every little thing that they stop and pick up, that's what you need to have in your office. Because children just love shiny things and pretty things and things that feel good. As much as we want to convince ourselves that a screen is the same, it's not as touching. There's not a child on this planet that you don't put a sandbox in front of them. They will tell you something. They can't keep their hands out of it. And at my center, you know, kids would come and they wouldn't want to talk to me. And they would say, I'm not talking to you. Okay. What are those? Well, those are rocks with symbols on them, but they make you talk. Don't worry about it. What do you do with them? Well, they're going to make you talk. Okay. Can I just do one? What do you do? What do you do? What do you do? Right? It just draws them in. So I'm not saying you're going to talk here. Sit down. We're going to talk. And I'll tell you something else that kids tell me. They say their psychiatrist get on their nerves. They have great relationships with their psychiatrist. I won the Mental Health Worker of the Year award in Colorado Springs. It was one of my proudest moments from the secular therapist who recognized my work over a bar. And I thought they would think I was a lunatic, but they gave me an award. What they like about me is they said my kids come prepared. Like they're like, you know, the pump that you pump outside. Well, by the time I make a referral to a psychiatrist, they're like, I just pump that thing once and those kids open up, you know, just automatic rapport. But oh, they say that they're, thank you. They think that they're therapists. They always say to me, like, you know, my therapist, well, like, the thing is, they, like, have me play checkers, and I know they're just trying to get my wall down. They're just trying to sneak it in there. I don't sneak it. I don't say this is a game. I say this is to help you talk. I'm serious about this. We're going to go through a you. Sometimes I draw the you for them and say, you have to be authentic. Like, that's how you're going to get better. And I'll even say to them, you don't have to, but the thing is, you're going to do it now, you're going to do it later. If I should do now, I'd do it now. So by fourth grade, I'd feel really good. And they go, oh, okay. Like, tell them the truth. I think a lot of times in therapy, we feel like we have to get them like off doing something on the side. And it's probably like, there's probably good theory for that. I just don't know what it is. But I just think, oh no, I'm just about talking to the kids. And it's amazing how much they'll talk to you. So just be honest, authentic. You know, if there is some reason that you play checkers, we don't know what it is. We're not therapists. Let the therapist figure that out. This is a picture that a girl drew me of healing. And this is, again, that spiritual integration. And this was one of my teenagers that had come to the center for a long time. And there's mountains in the background. And, you know, have any of you ever lived, well, you live in mountains here, sort of. But have you ever lived in the Rocky Mountains? Have you ever, anybody? Well, the shock of when I moved to the Rocky Mountains is, you know, when you're a child, you used to draw mountains that went up and down. I really thought mountains looked like that. And I was 30 years old. I really thought. So I was shocked when I saw how big mountains were. But they're turbulent a lot of the time. So when people say, I lift my eyes to the hills, you always think of like that perfect God bless America mountains. But a lot of times if you live by the mountains, you gauge your life by where the storm is over the mountain. And this girl said, the mountains were stormy. My stepfather died. And God came to me and holds me now. So she's the heart, the angel is God, and the mountains are pain. That's that spiritual integration all in one picture. Another teenager did this for me. She was a cutter. So these are razor blades with blood and tears and her heart. And you notice her heart is broken. And then she said, this is how I was before I healed. And here I am healed, but you notice her heart still has the bandage on it. It's still got a Band-Aid. So again, you know, it's authentic. It's truthful. That was my Christmas present 3 years ago from her. I loved it so much. Okay, so now we're back to our arch. Okay, so you get how to get children to talk. You give them a tool. You listen. You say, thank you, da-da-da. Now, do you have to be a robot? No. If you feel like crying, I don't care. You know what's bizarre to me? Somebody come in and say, you know, my mother, you know, whatever, and you sit there like, oh, really? Tell me more about that. Like, that's ridiculous. Like, just be authentic, and sometimes you're going to cry. You know what? The first time I ever saw a kid that cut, I'd heard of cutting. And I thought it was, like, going to be neat little marks, you know? And I've seen cutters that cut. But the first child that showed me that they cut, she was telling me her feelings, and she said, I have something to show you. And she pulled up her sleeve, and it was like crisscrossy, horrible self-hate. I've never seen anything like it. And I started bawling. And then you know what I did? I kissed it like I would a two-year-old who was showing me their boo-boo. And then I shamed out because I had gotten too emotional in the session. But that girl just called me the other day. She's going to law school. She's going to be an advocate for people who are abused. And she said to me, remember when you kissed my arm? Now, I don't encourage kissing children in this day and age, but you got to be real. And the more real you are, the more they're willing to be real. However, there is a difference in being real and vomiting. Vomiting on a child is not acceptable. So, a child comes and they say, you probably don't know what it feels like to be divorced because it's a really bad thing. And I go, actually, you know, I've been divorced and I kind of do know. And then she goes, really? Well, you seem pretty normal. You've been divorced. And then I really hit him with the twice. That's a good one. I never dreamed that God would use that to the glory. But you know what? It's funny. People come to me and they go, my child's on drugs. I knew you'd understand because you've been divorced twice. My, you know, whatever. I knew you'd understand. My child's gay. I knew you'd understand because you've been divorced twice. Like, it's like the worst thing. And so it's made me totally accessible. Like, I said to God, well, I'm glad you could bring some good out of my horribleness. This is great. Okay, whatever. So I'm not even ashamed of it anymore because, I mean, I am, but, you know, God works all things to the good. So the child says that. Now, what I don't say is, I'm divorced. What happened to your mother? Well, Daddy cheated. My first husband was a cheat. He wasn't. John, if you're watching this, you're not. Blah, 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 blah. I don't use it as my excuse to vomit on the child, right? Or if I've had a death, you don't trump the kid. But you can share, but you don't vomit. There's a difference. So just remember, if you start vomiting, just go ahead and eat another cookie and go get a drink of water. And then come back to the session. And then just be present with the kid again. So just don't vomit on kids. Nobody likes that. And don't vomit in your prayers either. Can we pray about this? And then you go on for like an hour and a half and the kid's laying down, but you're still praying. Like, don't vomit. Just pray short and simple. Like, just get it over with. Okay. You know, pray deeply. Short. That's my thing. You can, you know, you can go down in the depths of a prayer really quick. You don't have to make it like a 20-minute prayer. Okay, because then kids won't ever want to pray with you again. They'll be like, oh, no, that was a really long prayer. I don't want to do that. All right, so you see on our thing there, so we're halfway through our model. Now, the child, you've already built rapport, and in the church, that's our job. Build rapport, build rapport, build rapport. And you're going to notice what a child does when they get stressed out. You're going to know that, like, some kid likes a peanut butter cookie and other kids are allergic to peanut butter. Whatever. You're just going to build rapport. But when you're ready to go into that core statement, you're going to add a symbolic language tool. Drawing, sand, rocks, whatever you want. I truly believe you could choose anything. Like, I believe right now if I said to you, now don't use the rocks, we're not going to do this, but I want you to find a symbol in this room of something of how you feel. You could use anything in this room. You could use that light. You could use that rocking chair. You could use St. Francis over there in the window. You could use the flowers on the table. Everything is symbolic to children. That's how they look. They're just amazed at symbols. So you don't even have to have anything. And for the kids that, like I said earlier, that have tattoos, good heavens, use them. For the kids that come and they've written all over their arm, read their arm before you tell them that you shouldn't write on themselves and they're going to get ink poisoning and go wash that off. At least look at what they wrote first. Notebooks, what they wear. Kids will forever wear stuff. And this one little girl that I met, I mean, she came in and she had dangly earrings this long. And I started to judge her because I thought, wow, whose mother would let them wear dangly earrings that long? That's crazy. And they were her mother's. And her mother had abandoned the children, but she had left her earrings. And so she wore those earrings every day. They're very important. And she said, it was school picture day. She wanted to wear her beautiful earrings. And I just thought, oh, I wonder what the photographer thought. How cute is that? All right. So you're going to go down here. Now, we're going to turn children into eggs. So a child comes to you and they have their little shell on. And we all have our shells too, right? What you're doing in this space as you go down in this discovering conversation to the core statement is you're letting them take their little shell off. And then you're holding this little fragile egg in your hands. Now that is trust, and that is love. And that's why when sexual violations happen between pastors and kids or teachers and kids or whatever, it's because that child trusted that person and they got scrambled. It's why it's so painful, which means, again, you know, I don't mean to hammer safe sanctuaries, but it's so important to make sure that the people that do this work are good boundary people. So you've got that little egg, and also you don't want to say anything that, you know, would hurt that little egg. When they get eggy is when they're at their core statement. And then there's a moment where they realize they're eggy. They don't have their shell. They're just a little yolk. And they will change the subject. Then you're done for that session. Don't push them beyond that. Now, you're really going to feel good. You get down there and you're like, whoa, we're getting really deep. Tell me more about your picture. What's this? What's this? What's this? And they're going like, are we done yet? Can I have another cookie? When's my mom coming back? How long till Sunday school gets over? And end it. Do not push them past because they've gone as far as they can go for that session. And also, it's not a contest. All you're doing is getting to a little piece of authenticity, and you're going to make a relationship. This is going to go on. It's not a one-time deal with this child. You're going to see this child again. And hopefully, you know, you're going to have many of these conversations, and it will just keep going around. So don't push them any further. Let the you start coming back up then. Because this is the most important part of the work. Now you say, oh my gosh, this is the most important part? I thought getting them to talk was the most important part. It's an important part. It's the second half of this that God is going to do God's work. So you're the first half, they're talking to you. The second half, you are silent, and they're going to spend time in prayer, and God is going to step in and heal them. This is when God really can do God's work. So that core statement is like as authentic as the child can get. And core statements are extremely embarrassing for people, extremely embarrassing. So I have this guy that worked in my building, Steve Roberts, and he's a therapist, and I like Steve a lot. He's a nice guy. And I would tell, and I don't know what his vibe was, but I just felt like talking to Steve. So we'd get on an elevator, like on the first floor, and by the third floor, I would tell him things that I've never told anybody. You know, oh, I've got a tooth that's acting. I mean, I just would bare my soul to the guy. And then I'd get off the elevator and I'd think, oh, I bet he never wants to ride on an elevator with me again. You know when you tell your truth and then you're embarrassed that you did it? That's called shame out. We all do that. It's when you're talking to somebody, like I was talking about earlier, and they look at their watch and you realize that you've kept them and you were talking about your health issues and you're embarrassed. That's kind of shame out. Kids do the same thing. When you get really vulnerable and you have no shell left and you are who you are, we don't live in a society that values that. You know, we're all supposed to be up in the upper third, right? So they feel shy. And they can shame out. And so we don't want them to shame out. So what we do is we introduce prayer as a time to just sit with that. There's no reason to be ashamed if you cry. There's no reason to be ashamed that you're upset. There's no reason to be ashamed that you have said something, you know, like, I hate my mom's boyfriend. You're allowed to have your feelings. And we just sit there. And the children in my study, when I did my doctoral dissertation and we studied this model, you know, I said to the children, where did you experience healing? And universally they said, in the prayer time. Now that was a little humbling for me because I really did sort of think it was my personality, but it wasn't. It's in that quiet time. So after you do the core statement, you introduce another, it's the same stuff as you use to get them to talk. It's a sandbox. It's a candle to light. It's a music to play. It's whatever you want. And they just spend time in quiet with that core statement. Sometimes they'll draw a picture of it. Sometimes it's just breathing. This is my hobosphere, I think it's called, or something like that. And they just breathe in. You love the series of pictures, you can imagine. Wait, I don't know why this isn't clickety so well now. Oh, wait, there you go. And then they breathe out. This is a little sandbox, and they can use a toothpick. It's like a little film canister or something. I don't even know. You put M&Ms in them for weddings. And we put sand in that, and they can play with it with a toothpick. Sandboxes are great, right? Because you can wipe it away. Nobody can see what they ever wrote. They can write bad words. They can make symbols of anger, whatever they want. Journals are great. So there's like anything. This is a prayer jar. They put their prayers in there. They light a candle, sit quietly. I mean, again, this is what you guys are good at, right? This is why you became children's ministers. Like, you like crafts and stuff like that. So just get all your stuff out and make it prayer. This is my camouflage candle. It's one of those moments where I felt judgmental. Somebody donated this to me. I didn't want camouflage in my office because I'm like not, I'm a pacifist, blah, blah, blah. Well, military kids love that candle. I've been through about four of those. So again, don't let your stuff, little Zen sandbox. So you see, these are all prayers, and the children just use these, a labyrinth, whatever. And then the thing is, here's what you don't do. You don't explain it to death. Here's a labyrinth. In the center, you should leave something, blah, blah, blah. That's adults. That's adults. Do you ever go to J.K. Rowling's website? Have you ever done her thing, like the woman that wrote Harry Potter? Okay, you know what? I have. I went to her first one, and then I went to her one now. I don't know what to do. I don't understand it. I sit there going like, where are the instructions? I'm trying to pull down the instructions. But my son, who was, you know, young when Harry Potter came out, he got on there, whoa, opening a drawer, looking at a thing, blah, 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 blah. Same with video games. I sit there and I go, how do you know what Batman's supposed to do? They just play till they figure it out. Same with prayer. Don't explain it to death. Just give them a prayer tool and let God speak to them. And it's crazy because none of the kids go like, I played. They go, well, then when I was in prayer, God said. I mean, God is so alive. Just let God do God's thing. Hand say, you know, what would you like for your prayer? I'd like to light a candle. Okay, light a candle. They'll be like, you may want to feel the love of God in the light of the candle. Just let them light a candle. And then you just, whoop, and pray. And so in this second half, what you're doing is you're praying for that child. You're praying that they find what they need. You're just praying, okay? Then you have to send them out into the world. Oh, prayer beads, prayer crayons, see, everything. Anything that is labeled, has a ribbon or a bell on it, becomes holy. So these are just regular crayons that somebody melted all the, you know those boxes of leftover crayons you have? They made them in muffin tins and they called them prayer crayons. So the children, it's funny because if we, they would draw with the one crayons. And then I would say, well, you can just use these crayons. And they'd be like, oh no, I need the prayer crayons, which were just, and they didn't even work that well because she put glitter in them and it kind of messed them up. Like the glitter, every time there was a glitter, they didn't work. This is a little, so see, it just goes on and on. Okay. Let's scoot forward. So see, this is what it looks like. There's a lot of different sessions. Sometimes you go low, sometimes you go high. And eventually, you find healing. Now, can you already see how this works in a church and Bible stories and stuff like that? You're going to use the same model. You're going to take them out of that upper third into like the heart of God. But we're just working on hurting kids for now, so we won't get into that. Okay, now we'll keep that for a second. Now, over here, you got one last thing to do. So, they come in, they're acting happy whether they're happy or not. They've had trauma, you know they're not. You don't say, stop acting happy. You just build rapport. Chit, chat, chit, chat, chit, chat. Fun, fun, fun. You use their jewelry. You use their tattoos. You use anything you can. You know, who's the big team? You know, we use the Broncos. Everything's Peyton Manning. Woo, woo. Okay, so use whatever you want. Then you get serious. Who said same here? I knew I loved you. Oh, that's right here. That's right. Oh, my gosh. Oh, I love that we share that. Okay. Then you're going to introduce your symbolic language tool, and that's just going to be all the stuff you have in your office. But if you put it in a little basket, it looks special, and the kids are drawn to it, right? So no instructions. You just get the basket out, and it's inviting, and then kids scoot over, right? I remember when I went to visit my cousin once, I wanted to talk to my cousin, and she was beautiful. She was like 17, and I must have been 5. And I remember thinking, how can I get my cousin to talk to me? And, you know, she did not like me, but I was a 5-year-old. And so I had paper dolls. And I purposely acted like I couldn't punch out my paper dolls. And then Linda had to scoot over and help me. And that's how I learned about children. You don't have to say, everybody scoot over, da-da-da. You just go, look what I've got. You put it out and they go, what's in that basket? And you go, over they come, so easy. So you get out your sacred tools, you have them with you, and then you just enter this discovery conversation. The child makes a core statement. This is authentic, so I'm just going to put a little mouth like that because it might be sad, it might be happy, it might be whatever. It's just a core statement. You'll know that they're done because they'll be done. So be aware. Don't get caught up in your own ego of like, wow, I'm doing a great job here. This is really working. Just stay connected with the child. When they're done, let it go. But immediately say, I heard what you said. Wow, thank you for being honest. You don't even have to parrot it back to them. You can if you want. You don't have to. Just say, wow, okay, that's important. We're going to sit here for a minute, and we're going to enter a time of prayer. You bring out the prayer tools. They're in another basket. They look exactly like the basket you just got out, except now it has a tag on it that says prayer. The kids get their basket. Or I had shelves in my office, which were really cool, and they had like all kinds of cool stuff. Then you let them pray, and in this section, you're praying. Now, what's nice, if the kid chooses to draw their prayer, it's nice if you draw a prayer too, because nobody likes to be stared at when they're praying, right? But remember that these aren't equal times. They're equal importance. That's why I have both sides. So this might take 25 minutes, and this might take 3.5 minutes. But the reason I divide it down the middle is because they're of equal importance. Don't end down here. The therapists in Colorado Springs were really interested in my work. Well, in Denver, I mean, Colorado. What's that state? Colorado. We're really interested in my work, and people around the country have been really interested in my work, the psychiatric community, because they're fascinated with this part. See, a lot of times in therapy, they're like, oh, your session's up, leave. But the problem is people suicide and do crazy things or won't go back. And by adding this, how does the child leave? They leave happy. They don't leave upset. Nobody that leaves upset wants to go back. I saw that movie, like Leaving Las Vegas or something with Nicolas Cage, and like it's the saddest thing in the world, and then it ends sad. And then I thought, I'll never want to see that movie again. And I was mad. I was mad for like 4 days. Have you seen that movie? Have you seen that movie? And it's because it left me down here. Nobody wants to be left. It's a good thing he's cute. I almost turned against him. Okay, so you go down here. They make their core statement. This is prayer. The child is praying. You're praying. Let's say the child prays for 30 seconds. Okay. Let's say they pray for 3 minutes. Okay. You respect that. People say to me, how do you know they're praying? How do you know they're praying? I don't need to know. God knows. I've held a sacred space. God is there. We're quiet. Be still and know that I am God. I'm just like, God's there. And children will report back that they prayed. They get it. So again, we're not their judges. It just kills me when people are like, what if they're faking? What if they're just reflecting? Who cares? God's going to work in that silence, right? I mean, Elijah, when he was in that cage and all that scary stuff started happening to him, you know, he wasn't exactly, you know, on his knees praying. He was just hiding. And God jumped right in there. So, okay. So then we're going to pray. And then we're going to bless them. If I am known for anything in this whole country, I'm the woman that does blessings. Somebody said to me the other day, you invented blessings. Don't tell Jesus that, because he blessed the children long before I did. You bless them. And a blessing looks like this. You have done amazing work. Thank you. You came in here and you became authentic. Thank you. What's a symbol of what you need? Well, I need a heart because my heart is broken and I want a heart that's not broken. I want a sword like the one from that boy pulled out of that rock, like in Camelot. Okay? I want a bunny rabbit because they're fluffy. Okay? And then you get some water. You can just use your finger. I personally like water, but we use this thing called blessing balm, and it's chapstick, basically. And you make that symbol on their little hand or on their little forehead, whichever they want. And you say to them, God is proud of you. God is with you. And then you squunch them like nuzzle. And you say, get out. Go home. Your mom's out there. Your dad's waiting. You're done. The blessing does two things. It firms up that what they've done is important. What you don't want is for a kid to get in a car after they've seen you and think, I made a fool out of myself. I'm weak. I'm stupid. All of those messages that our society gives us, that if you go into your place of authenticity, you're stupid, you're weak, you're not strong, you're all those things you don't want to be. And if you think you don't have those, try crying in front of a stranger and you'll know exactly all those feelings. And it says to the child, this was important. I heard you. God heard you. And God is with you. It also says to you that you are not God. So you want to take all these little kids home with you, but what it does is it gives them back to God. So while you're blessing them and you're saying thank you, blah, blah, and then the squunch is you're saying to God, okay, I have promised this child that you are with them. Do not leave them for one second. I can't take care of all the kids in the world. You can't take care of all the kids in the world, but God can. We are carved into the palm of God's hand. You know how close that is? You know, it's always that picture where we're holding. No, we're not held by God. We're carved into God's hand. You think that you want to take that child home and your heart is breaking? Imagine God. And God has the ability to stay with that child until their pain ends. So that's our job, is to just do this. And you have to believe in this, because when the child comes, you'll think to yourself, oh, I can't do this, or this won't work, this is too simple, or whatever. But I'm telling you, all you're doing is creating a sacred space, and in that sacred space, they're going to go into the heart of God, and they will heal. They will heal. And you say, how do you know? Life, death, resurrection. God will not leave that child until they're healed. And they might be 50 years old. Life, death, resurrection. God will not leave that child. So the blessing is just to remind yourself that God is more powerful than you are. God is more powerful than you can even imagine. God loves that child more than you do. God has more compassion for that child than you do. So the blessing is really, really important. And so that's the model. Now, I just want to go forward just a little bit to show you how you can use this in the church. This is now my new model of God-centered transformation. I love my sister-in-law who made this beautiful slide for me. And healing from crisis is one way that children go into the heart of God. But they also can go into the heart of God through the Bible story, through sacred text, through prayer practices, and soulful self-discovery. And there's probably a million more ways that they can go into the heart of God. But remember that parents right now are saying, for the first time in history, parents are not bringing their children to church. So it used to be everybody didn't go to church during college, but then after college, they decided to come back to church once they had a baby. Well, for the first time in the history of the church, and not the United Methodist Church, the church with great big C, it's in every denomination, parents are saying, I'm not going to bring my kid back to church. It isn't relevant. Well, imagine being a church that says, we're ready for hurts and pains, and we're going to journey with your child through their whole life. Suddenly, church becomes really, really relevant. And yet, for so many churches, they're afraid of this, they're not touching it, they don't even understand that these kids are hurting. Imagine what would happen if this was your church. And I've seen churches all over the country that start these programs, and they grow. Now, I don't want to sell this as a church growth thing, because I think that's tacky. But the reality is, when you hurt is a time when you reach out for God. It'd be nice for somebody to be ready. I had a guy bring his kids to my center. His wife had a really bad cancer in her spine. She lived, and she was not supposed to, but she lived. And he brought him, and he said, I said, oh, you know, how did you hear of me or whatever? And he says, my mother-in-law goes to your church. And so she told me about First Steps. And he says, but, you know, I didn't really want to come to a United Methodist minister. I didn't want to come to a United Methodist church. And by this time, I had moved back into the church just so I could have one office. And, you know, and he said, but... And I said, oh, well, you know, what are you, a faith tradition? He says, oh, I'm Episcopalian. I love the Episcopal Church. I love it. And he said, but the thing is, I took my kids to our pastor, and I went in and I said, you know, my wife is really, really sick. How can you help me? And he said, he handed me some secular materials about the stages of grief. And I said to him, hey, I already got that at the hospital, and I got it from the school counselor. What can you do for my kids about God? And the pastor said, here's more secular material. Now, I'm not faulting that pastor. I'm just saying, imagine if he'd had that same scenario and he went to the pastor and the pastor said, well, we have a holy listener that's prepared to meet with your child and will journey with you through all of this. Imagine. And I understand recruitment is difficult. I recruited a lot of people for a lot of years. But holy listeners, they're easy to recruit because these are people that have the heart for kids. And they are often people that went through a traumatic experience and didn't have anybody journey with them, and they appreciate it, they understand it. So I have found that these holy listeners on Sunday morning are the easiest thing to recruit. In fact, some of our Sunday school teachers wanted to jump ship, and I'd be like, oh no, good first grade teacher, you stay right where you are. All right, so at church, I just wanted to show you a couple things. And this is all, you know, First United Methodist, where I spent the bulk of my career. But this is our candle of hope. And it has a bell on the bottom. I found it at an antique shop. So every Sunday at the beginning, we have an opening. And we said to the children, who needs the candle of hope? And the children would come forward and they would say, I do. I flunked my math test. My parents are divorcing. My whatever. And everybody says, oh, you might find out stuff. Right. Okay, they're allowed to be authentic. But they came up and they would light this candle. My dog died, da-da. They would light the candle. We would ring the bell saying, you know what? This is not the end of your story. The story goes life, death, resurrection. And then pretty soon all the children would say, I would say, this is not the end of the story. And the children would say, it's life, death, resurrection. And then I'd say, blow out the candle, one, two, three. And they'd all blow it once. I'd blow it out and everybody'd be happy. So you don't light it 50 times. You just light it once. Little candle of hope. For kids. This is a prayer shawl. I think it's one of the kindest gifts you can give to a child, and it's just when they're crying or whatever, you wrap them in comfort. Very symbolic language. This is our holy listener. I'm here to listen, the holy listener. And so at the beginning, after they light the candle of hope, I would say to them, you know, not everybody has the perfect life. Does anybody need the holy listener today? And then I'd say to the kids, what does a holy listener do? And like little robots, they would say, they do not solve our problems. They listen to us, because I had told them that so many times. And I said, that's right. And so kids would raise their hand, and the holy listener would just go get them. And we had a blanket out in the middle of the room, and they'd pull them out of class. The holy listener would come there. If a child melted down in class, rather than have a discipline program of three strikes, you're out, or a reward system, whatever, they just said, you know what, something's not right. Why don't you go talk to the holy listener? And we found out that the bulk of children that act out in Sunday school needed a holy listener. Something's the matter. Children want to please us. They don't want to disappoint us, but they need that one-on-one. And there's no space in a Sunday school curriculum for them to share. So the holy listener was a great addition, and we love that. And here's the holy listener's basket. It's got the rocks, some crayons, some paper, and my hairdresser, actually, I don't have a good picture of this quilt, but it has the holy listening stones around the edge. My hairdresser made it for me. And then this is just a little quiet place to pray and a children's prayer book. So if they wanted to, they can go in a little chapel, write their prayer in the book. And I learned so much about the children through the prayer book. And I would just go in there once a week and read it, and then they could just pray. So you see, it's just creating spaces for them. This is my latest creation. My nephew made this for his Scout Award, and there's one of these in First Steps, and there's one of these in First United Methodist Church, but it's a prayer table. I got the idea from the busy box, you know, that children play, and they open it, and a bee pops up, and they turn a thing, and whatever. So this is a prayer tool table, and those things sit in the table. There's holes, and they sit in there, and you have your markers to write with. That flips over. It's a chalkboard. There's clay in both of those things. There's the sandbox. There's a labyrinth back there. There's little symbols to use in the sandbox, and then in the middle is a candle, and the child self-regulates. So they open the box, get out their holy candle, make their space sacred, do their prayer time, and I just sit there and let them do their prayer. And then when they're done, they turn the candle off, put it back in the box, and they're done. They say, I'm done. So it's just a little time to spend with God at their little prayer table. I have the plans for that if anybody wants to, you know, I mean, you can pretty much figure that out, but you know, he had to do the plans for his scout thing, and he said, give it to anybody that wants them. So there's my little prayer box. Sometimes specific needs come up for children, and we don't want to not address those. So this is the military blessings. We had a tree, and then if your dad or mom deployed, you hung a red, white, or blue ribbon on that tree. At one point, I had nearly 30% of all my children had a parent deployed. Do you think those children acted good and well-behaved on a Sunday morning? They were nuts. And how do you think my preschool teachers, who all had a deployed parent, could tolerate preschoolers? It was hard. So we did a little thing where we started making these bracelets, and we call them Everlasting Circles of Love, and we said, you know, love stretches. And so our military kids wore these. We tried to make them cool, like those Avon ones. I don't know how cool it looks, but the kids thought they were cool. And they would wear them, and we would remember, this is a military kid. We're not gonna squanch this kid. They're going to need TLC. And then we sent this deployment with the fathers. There's the little bracelet. These are groups when we would have kids who had gone through grief, whatever. We would just gather together and do groups. We had a hope for the holiday for kids who had lost loved ones. And I just want to end with what happens when you do this. And some of you have heard this story, but it has a new part to it. So I have this little girl, and her name's Jessie, and she was 7 when her father killed himself. And her mother was a drug addict, and so she'd been living with her father in a school bus. That was their home. He had made a school bus into a house for her, and very, very poor. And they would just live until somebody discovered they were on their land, and then he would move the school bus. It still ran, I guess. And when he killed himself, she went back to live with her mother. And her mother was mentally ill, had a lot of drug abuse issues, had a lot of boyfriends in and out of the house, whatever. And I loved her. I just, you know how those kids, you're not supposed to have favorites, but you do. I think she's my all-time favorite kid because she just was so raw when I met her, and she was so brave. Like, she went through that you like nobody's business, and she was just so, you know. Well, she came to the center for a long time, and then we did this Hope for the Holidays where they would come. But she would call me at holiday time, and she would say, her mom would call and say, you know, she needs to see you. And maybe, you know, and her mom would never keep the appointment. So even though she was supposed to be coming on a regular basis, her mom wouldn't keep them. And anyway, so she came in to see me this one time, and she said, you know, it's been like 5 years. It'd been 3 years. She was 10 years old. It's been 3 years. I can't believe I still have to come see you at the holiday. She said, you know, I'm going to write a book that says, I am the little girl who's fine with the death of my dad except at holidays. And I said, you know what? My parents have been gone for 25 years, and I still miss them at holidays. Your parents died? Yeah. And it makes me really sad at holidays. Holidays are particularly hard. You can come here for as many holidays as you want. So we get done, and we get done with the session, and she stands up, and I have this blessing balm that we use, and she gets the blessing balm, and she goes, Leanne, what would you like for your blessing? What is a symbol? And I said, oh, honey, this is your session. This isn't my session. And she says, Leanne, if I'm going to do your job someday, I need to practice. So I said to her, well, my symbol would be their initials, Polly and Walt, P and W. And she so lovingly blessed me with a P. And then she so lovingly blessed me with a W. And then she held my hand and she said, I'm proud of you. God is with you. And then I blessed her. The next Christmas, I get this package. It's outside my door. And I open it. She was real bossy, by the way. I didn't mention this. Like, it wasn't just the blessing. She'd come in. Her sessions would go this quick. She'd walk in and be like, for my holy listening time, I would like to use the rocks, and then I'd like to use this prayer. Did you ever think about getting some purple crayons? Because I feel like purple is missing. Oh, you know, she's a real bossy little thing. I loved her. I love those bossy bad kids. I love them. So anyway, she came in. I had this gift. And one of the things that she told me was, she said, you know, you could teach children to knit on their fingers, and it could be a prayer. Did you ever think about that? And I was like, no, I never did. Well, for that Christmas, then she brought me this, and it was in a little bag, and that's my thing. And I pull this out, and I took a picture of it so you could see how long it is, right? And it's like goes on forever, like from here to that window. And I said to her, oh, I love it. And she says, it's a scarf. I said, oh, of course it was. You know, how could I miss that? It's like this skinny. And she said, oh, and you know what? I knitted it on my fingers. And I said, you knitted this whole thing on your fingers. She said, and you know what? I prayed for you. Because I remember from last year the holidays are really hard for you. And I just prayed that God would take care of you during this Christmas. And then she puts it on me. And then she says, I want you to wear this every day till Christmas. And by the way, how many kids are coming to the Christmas party this year? I said, well, I think we have 25 coming. Okay. We get to the Christmas party, and she says, at the end, I'm going to do the blessings. And I said, well, honey, we have a theme, you know, and we're going to do like the snowflake blessing. She's like, no, I'm going to do the blessing at the end. Okay. She comes in. She says, okay, now that you've all done a great job, you were authentic. I am living proof that you will feel better, but not at the holidays. You'll always feel bad at the holidays. And I was like, move on. And then she says, and I have made each of you a scarf. They're all pink. We got boys. We got teenagers. And now I will bless you. Now the parents have arrived. She's still blessing. Still blessing. She has one left. One of the mothers came over and knelt down and said, could I have a blessing? On went that scarf. And she said to me, thank you. You healed me, and now I'm going to heal others. See, when we take people into the heart of God, they are transformed, and they will be able to minister like nobody's business. I hate that this child's father killed himself, but my goodness, what a healer she has become. I left my church a year ago, just a little bit over a year ago. I got a call from her grandmother, from her aunt, who they're now living with the aunt. And because the mother had and found herself homeless with on drugs, whatever. And I'd met the aunt before I left town, but the aunt called and she said, Leanne, you're not going to believe what happened. Their mother has suicided. She didn't even have my phone number. She found me on the web, like Googling me till she found my website. And she said, I know you don't live here anymore, but is there any way that you could talk to the girls on the phone? You know, they really just want to hear your voice. And she has a younger sister. And I said, well, you know, as God would have it, I am coming to town on Tuesday. I was going back for a funeral. And I said, when is the funeral? Tuesday morning. I said, I will meet with them any time that week. I'm there for the whole week. So on Wednesday morning, they came to the session. And, you know, I met with them. And little Jesse, who's now a teenager, doing great, says to her sister, look, you have to get your feelings out. And guess what? Leanne taught me how to do this. So after today, I'm going to be your partner. And she looks at me and she says, who would have ever dreamed when I blessed you that I would be using this with my own little sister? Now that's holy work. I've actually had people say to me, How is this sacramental? I don't even know what they're talking about. It's so holy. And that's what we're called to do, is this holy work with children. Now, I know that most of us went and became children's ministers because we like crafts and we like to sing and we like to do stories. But if you're not the one to do this work, then I just encourage you to find the people that are willing to do this work and let them do it. You saw the statistics. You see how many children need this work? They're in our churches. They're outside of our churches. Imagine when the church gets back to the business of healing and blessing children. Then we're going to change lives, and then those children are going to go out, and they're going to be healers, and then those kids are going to go out, and they're going to be healers. We can no longer say, I don't think there are hurting children. There are. We either step up to the plate or we don't. And I'll tell you, those of us of faith are the ones that can do it. Nobody wants to see a child hurt. Nobody can stand to see a child cry. You know, the most annoying sound on the earth is a child crying. It's because every fiber of our being wants to fix that child. Only people that have enough faith to understand that it is through the darkness and through death that resurrection happens, can do this work. This is the work of the church. We need to stand up and be the people who know the story. Life, death, resurrection. It is our story. It is the truth. I pray that we will become the church and meet the needs of these children, because they are the ones that will carry on this story. If we drop the ball now, they will never carry on the story. Thank you for listening. I think it's lunchtime. Yes. Does anybody have a question or comment or anything before lunch? Or is it lunchtime? Oh, okay. Okay. Yes, ma'am. Yeah. Right, right. Oh, that's right. And by the way, if you have questions and you formulate them over lunch, we'll have time for questions after lunch too. Like, we'll go deeper into how we do this.
Well, we're, you know, as teachers, we're trying to figure out how do we implement this, because we're teaching, and how do we stop and do that.
Right.
And I taught theater for 20 years, and so I did a lot of, when you work in theater, especially, I taught all the way from preschoolers to college students. Theater, emotions come out. I mean, you're portraying emotions, so, and you have to connect with your own emotions. So it was so important for me working with all age kids to know where my kids were before rehearsal started.
Sure.
Because if they were in a fragile place, then you couldn't push as hard. You couldn't go as far.
Right.
So, and as I taught, I would find kids, because they would start connecting to me emotionally, you know, they knew it was a safe place to show emotion, whether it was their emotion or an emotion they were acting, that the first thing I would do is they would come in and run to me to tell me whatever emotion they were having when they walked in the door.
Nice.
And I taught at one point 60 kids. Well, I would teach kids from 60 different schools. They would come to a community theater. Like, and I taught all ages during the week, but we had 800 kids over a week. And I taught probably half of those over a week. But,
wow.
They would come, and they would come running to me, and they'd want to tell me their adventures of the day. Well, when you have a class of 18 kids, you can't let them all tell you their story.
Right.
So I created something, and I give it to you as it may be a way for you to start holy listening without starting the class, starting a holy listening space.
Sure.
I call it checking in. And what I would do is the kids, I always worked in circles at the beginning of everything I did, and every kid would have to check in, and I would give them a different thing to check in as, kind of like your symbols that you were talking about around the room.
Mm-hmm.
And I would say, okay, today you're going to check in as a type of weather.
Nice.
And, you know, how are you today? How's your day been?
I love
as
that.
A type of weather. And so you immediately can start seeing, I'm thunderstorms. I'm or in some of the kids, you can look at them and they'll go, I'm partly cloudy. And I'm like, is that good to you or bad to you? It's great. I'm not a sunshine kid. You
right.
know? Especially when you're getting to know kids, it gives you a sense of, this is never going to be the happy, happy kid. Then the next time it's checking as a type of shoe. And some of them are going to be literal
nice.
And are going to say the shoe that they're wearing. But then you also can see this kid's got more layers.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to take longer to get to that kid. And you got the kid that's going, I'm the high heel red pump, you know, and you get to see their personality, but they can also check in as something sweet. But the more general the thing that you give them to check in, the more you can see how hard it's going to be to get to the layers. And what I found is the kids that have the more layers and they're more hesitant to let you see the real stuff, they're the ones that are hiding the stuff. So you can start doing this with groups where it's safe.
I love it.
And I also did it at the closing of everything. At every rehearsal, I would say, tell me one positive thing today.
Right.
It could be somebody made me laugh or somebody, and I'd just do that closing thing. And I could also start sensing that kid who wants to tell me something more, but they won't tell me in front of the group. So it may give you a place where, if you're like me and you're the youth director and you can't stop everything.
Do that one-on-one.
But you can start finding the windows of opportunity to get to the one-on-ones by what you're hearing, what they'll share in front of the group. Right. And I just call it checking in, and that's their way of, they have to tell me something. You know, they have to tell me something. And mm-hmm. if you tell them, well, how's your week? We all know what they're going to say. Fine.
Yeah.
Was there anything exciting at school today? No. But, you know, if you kind of get them something creative, like your stones, but it's a verbal to start with, or you could do it with symbols. I've done it with symbols.
But it was still symbolic. Like, what you're doing is still symbolic language, right? Like a cloud. Right. Tell me your weather. So you got that symbolic language thing happening. Ideal. And see, as you do that, what you're doing, too, is you're setting a rapport that you do care about how they feel. And so when their world does bottom out, you've already sort of set the tone for that. That's what that, you know, check-in candle does too. It says, we're not a place, you don't be ashamed if you've had a bad week at school or if you're bullied or whatever. It brings all that, it says, we don't have to stay in our upper third. And, you know, it's interesting, your theater thing, it was actually a guy named Goffman. Before I realized this was life, death, and resurrection, I was looking at theater stuff, and actually, he calls this liminal space. When you leave yourself and you go into liminal space, and that's what acting is. They, you know, you're feeling those emotions. It's just that you're tapping into your own stuff. So you you found me out. I forgot about good old Goffman, who was my first guy that I studied. So, yeah. Yeah. Anything else? All right. So after lunch, we'll have some questions and stuff. But as you look at, like, how do I do this? How do I do this? I mean, I think that the first step is to say you're going to do something, like you're going to light a candle or whatever. But the easiest thing that you can do in a church is to find a holy listener and give them a basket and have them sit down and listen to children. And then you go, well, I'm not a trained person. Yes, you are. You have this. You have this. You show it to them. And it's not rocket science. That's the beautiful thing about it. I keep thinking, I want to work with the missionaries around the world because there's such a shortage of mental health. And this may not be the mental health that everybody needs, but it is a first step towards mental health. And if we could get people sort of keeping them lubed and greased and ready to, you know, go through their cycle of feelings, imagine then when bad stuff happened, how ready they would be to go do that. And imagine if you worked through a pain, let's say 3 times when you were a child, minor things, and then something awful happens to you at age 11 or 14 or 20, you already have sort of a model. You understand this is what we do. So again, it's kind of early intervention. It's sort of like training. You know, we don't expect a child to read War and Peace in the second grade, but we teach them their letters. So, you get used to that. So the easiest thing that I found are these holy listeners. And a lot of times you'll find a social worker, a teacher, a loving person. But, you know, don't kid yourself. Sometimes psychiatrists can't do this work because they're too busy psychoanalyzing everybody. And so you just want to get your person. And another question that always comes up is, what if a child tells me something that I need to report to social services? Then you need to report that to social services. And in all of my years with children, because children are very selective and they understand, children that are really in the social service, you know, arena, they know what will get them into trouble and what they'll tell. So I have worked, you know, thousands of children in the local church for 30 years, and I've only had to call social services maybe 3 times. But I'll tell you what I do every time I move into a community is I make a trip to the social service place, and I meet the people. Because I think you listen on TV and sometimes you think that the social service people are like that mean woman in 101 Dalmatians that's trying to steal the Dalmatians or something. And you meet these people and you realize, or you get frustrated because it doesn't work fast enough. You know, probably the biggest disappointment is you call social services and they never call the family. And you get frustrated. But when they're people that you're calling, and I find a contact person, and I say, if anything came up in my church, could I call you? And they say, absolutely. Absolutely. So when I call, I'm not just calling a random person, I'm calling a person. And I haven't had to call that person, but they're just in shock that somebody from a church would come and they're like, what do you want to do? Like sometimes they won't even meet with you. You have to show up there because they're just like, why are you calling me? They're so used to being yelled at that they're afraid of you. So when you go and say, I really want to work in partnership with you, teach me what the warning signs are, show me whatever. I mean, they are just a wealth of information, and they went into social work because they love children the same as you went into your jobs because you love children. We're not the good guys, the bad guys, or the, you know, same with the psychologists. I get to know the psychiatrists in town and the psychologists, and then I can make referrals to people that I know, and I say, the kids, this is my friend, we go to lunch, and they say, oh, okay. So don't hesitate to cross breed. It takes a village. If it's a whole pie, we're one slice of the pie. We're not the whole pie, but neither is the medical community the whole pie. Like, it's a pie. We all get a little piece. The teachers, the parents, us, the church, we're all just pieces of a pie. And it would be delicious if we'd all show up.